Welcome again to Profile. I'm Ian Boyne, your host. We continue our interviews on religious movements this afternoon. We look at the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and in our studios is Archbishop Isaac, who is Archbishop in charge of the Ethiopian Orthodox Churches for the Western Hemisphere. He talks about the current crisis in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, as well as the relationship between the Church and the Rastafarians. We answer your questions. Do stay tuned. Archbishop Isaac, it is so good to have you on the program.
Thank you.
The Ethiopian Orthodox Church is known by many people, but a lot of people do not know exactly what the Ethiopian Orthodox Church stands for. Many people think it's a Rastafarian church, it's a church of the Rastafarians. You are the man who established a church in Jamaica right. In 1970, right. That's what, 25 right. years ago,
right.
You established a church
right.
Here. What is your relationship with the Rastafarian community?
Okay. Well, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is known as the ancient Christian church in the world.
The oldest Christian church.
The oldest Christian church in the world. And it teaches Christ as Creator and Savior. And also maintain the apostolic tradition and succession.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when we come to the Rastafarians philosophy, it is well known, I don't have to explain their philosophy, but the church teaches differently, and the Rastafarians, not everybody, but most Rastafarians, then they have their own philosophy. Now, it will be very difficult for the church to give up this ancient belief and doctrine which exists from the time of the apostle. Now, also the church teaches Christianity and Christ our Savior. Well, I would say the majority of its members are from the Rastafarians.
In Jamaica?
In Jamaica, yes. Only in Jamaica.
You've attracted a lot of Rastafarians here.
As a matter of fact, between 1970 to 1978, about 20,000 people has been baptized.
20,000? That seems like an exaggerated
in Jamaica,
figure.
Really? No, not
20,000.
Really. Yes. And then what happened is that afterwards it was a lot of disappointment because so many Rastafarians expected that, you know, the church has to teach exactly.
Oh, so they felt that you would have embraced their ideology.
Yes. But it was difficult for me. Also, I want them to be in the church, and I would not condemn their belief, because every man is free to believe and worship the way he wanted. But
if he's a member of the church,
yes,
he must follow
the doctrines of the church. He must follow the teaching and doctrine of the church. That is.
And you don't accept this view that Selassie is God, divine. That Selassie was.
To them,
reincarnated Christ.
Yeah, to the Rastafarian, he is God. But to the Ethiopians and to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, he is not God.
He was a member of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church.
He was a member of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church.
Yes.
And a defender of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Really.
Yes. So why didn't he do more to dispel this heretical belief of the Rastafarians?
Well, you see,
he must have heard that these people felt that he was God.
Why didn't
he do something to dispel that myth?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, he sent me for this purpose.
He sent you?
Yes, he tried to introduce the culture and the teaching of our church. So that's why I came. It was not only the patriarch who sent me, but he himself.
He himself sent you?
Yeah, I was then a priest, a high priest in 1970. I was not a bishop. So they sent me, he selected me and sent me here to do that. That, if it was not for that, they might not have accepted me anyway.
So you came with Selassie's endorsement?
Yes, and Selassie is very important. He is the vehicle for the Rastafarian community to really come
accept
to
the church.
Yes, to accept the church, and I appreciate that too, you know. Also, I wouldn't say that the church teaching must change into other philosophy, but
baptized so many thousands.
Yes.
They left and went over to Boba Dread and you know, 12 tribes.
They did all over, yes.
They couldn't let go of this myth that Selassie was the returned Christ.
Many others still remain throughout the island. They are faithful and they worship. And we have 5 churches or 6 churches in the island.
You have 6 churches in the island, no?
Yeah, but they are, most of them are small. You know, bamboo, will built by bamboo and
I see. And small, so yes, small, small, yes, yes,
that's
yes.
right.
Okay.
We do have. And that is it, really, you know,
yeah.
that is it. And
now, what was your position on the dreadlocks? Did you like the dreadlock? Did you try to discourage them from wearing the dreadlocks?
No, first time I came, I never discouraged the dreadlock appearance, because I knew that this is what they want to be.
Yes.
And I say to myself, man must not be condemned because of his appearance.
Okay.
So it was, however, a problem in the public that, oh, this is Rastafarian church, Abba,
yes.
Mandafro is, at that time, the Rasta priest, and all this. And in fact, I advised some few people, and they cut it, and they called me Barba, Abba, Barba.
Abba, Barba.
Yeah, and this thing.
But you advised some of the Rastafarians to cut their hair?
I did, yes.
Oh, okay.
I did, because, you know, because many of them, they couldn't get job. And many of them also rejected to work. They say that they will work in Africa, and I encourage them to have their own work and to make establish businesses and all that. And they did, a lot of them.
So you try to help them to integrate in the society?
Of course, even the biggest artists, well-known artists who died now, like, I have to encourage them to go ahead and make it. Yes, you know.
I see.
Yes,
you baptized Bob Marley.
I did baptize Bob Marley. And the presence of his wife Rita Marley and his children.
Yes.
Yes, family, only the family, because he was not so willing to have it officially.
Probably.
It was difficult for him, yes.
To get it, yes.
Which I don't want to describe.
Okay,
you know?
Okay.
And anyway, this is what it happened, you know.
Yes. Now, your church also, you see, a lot of people don't understand, your Eminence, that the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is a Christian church. In fact, you are very close to the Roman Catholic Church. Your traditions are very similar to the Roman Catholic Church. If anybody were to go into an Ethiopian Orthodox Church, you would be amazed as to how the rituals are the same. You believe in the veneration of the saints.
Yes,
you believe in the veneration of Mary.
Right.
You know, the traditional doctrines.
We do. We do all
you have
this.
Maintained
yes.
of the Catholic Church.
Yes, it's really very little different. The difference is, we still have different, of course.
But certain minor differences.
Outside
papal infallibility.
Yeah.
The nature of Christ.
The nature of Christ.
And I think the Holy Spirit.
And the procession of the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Yeah, but those are the three minor things.
Those minor,
so you're an Orthodox Christian church.
Right. They will call them today that they are minor, you know, things. But before, they were considered important.
Yes, man.
You know,
those were the issues.
They were the things that people had been fighting from church to church.
Yes,
that's what it is.
Yes.
So now, with the Roman Catholic Church, we have also consultation program, we are learning of each other. I'm a member of the Oriental Orthodox Church and Roman Catholic Bishop Conference in the United States and Canada. We have been working together for 15 years.
Having dialogue with the Catholic Church.
Yeah, we're having dialogue and we are trying to understand each other, and
okay.
perhaps maybe one day we'll come together. That's
okay.
the hope. Yeah.
Yeah. We're going to take a break at this point. Later on we'll speak more about Bob Marley's relationship with the Ethiopian Orthodox Church and the role of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church today. We'll be back shortly. Welcome again to Profile. We're speaking to Archbishop Yisak, who is responsible for the Ethiopian Orthodox churches in the Western Hemisphere. Archbishop, your church would be opposed to concubinage, a man just living with a woman without marriage. A lot of Rastafarians love that practice.
Well,
what about Rastafarians who are members of your church? What if they engage?
The church does not agree with such a life, because the church believes in marriage. One man and one woman as it is from the beginning.
Not one man with seven women, like some Rasta man.
Not some, that is a Muslim tradition.
Muslim.
So, yeah, that's not a Christian tradition. So we do not practice that, and we do not allow to happen here.
So what do you do with members?
With our members.
What do you do with members who flout that?
Well, we advise them to limit themselves.
But you don't excommunicate them?
Well, we do not excommunicate them, but they listen to us. Yes. They are willing to listen.
But Bob Marley was a very good member at all. He was a most delinquent member when it came to sexual matters.
Well, Bob Marley
Why were you afraid to display him because he was a celebrity?
Let me tell you, no. Bob Marley was a man that he was coming along to learn so much about the principle of the church. Because I told him how His Majesty lived with one woman, with one wife. He only
had
one queen. Yes, and he believed. Some other people advised him that he is the grandson of David and Solomon, and Solomon and David had many wives and all that. But I told him, no, that's wrong. Just follow His Majesty. So he said, yes, Abba, I will follow His Majesty. And he was really coming to realize that, you know.
But he was a man who believed in a lot of women.
Well, that I don't know. That's his private things.
Yes.
I really don't know so much. But
you had to warn him at one time.
I did.
Well, there must be some reason why you warned him.
Yeah, when I heard something like that.
It's a public knowledge.
Yeah, he had some
of course children,
women other than his wife.
Yes,
I advised him many times, and he listened to me. Really, he said, "This, yes, you are right. I'm going to follow this." That's why he was.
So he was trying to.
Yes,
at least the church warned him.
He was really he was really trying. To follow this tradition, and when he was baptized, he cried for half an hour. And I considered it as
he cried.
It was repentant. He cried. He was washed out with.
What year Bob Marley was baptized in the church? You remember?
Oh, it was. I forget. It's about 7 months before he died.
He baptized late.
Yes.
7 months before he died.
Yes.
Okay.
It was late because it was even difficult before, you know, to even discuss matter because he was not a member of the church.
I see.
You know, so
after,
even though I was very close to him, you know.
Oh, you knew him long before you were baptized.
Yes. As a matter of fact, he was always ready to be baptized in Maxfield Avenue and called the media and all that, but for several reasons, he could not do it, and we have to put.
And his wife Rita is still a faithful member of the church.
Oh yes, her and her children from 1973, she was baptized. She never lived.
Oh, Rita was baptized early.
Oh yes, the main supporter.
Yes.
Yes, of the church and the very faithful.
Very faithful to
teach the teaching of the church all the brothers and sisters really.
Let me ask you, Archbishop, did Bob Marley in his sort of later months of his life, did he come to give up the view that Selassie was God? Did you have a discussion with him on that?
Well, let me tell you, Bob never even mentioned about His Majesty as God in front of me. He always asked me, Abba, who is Christ? I told him, Christ, Jesus Christ, the one who was crucified.
Yes.
Good. That's he was. You see, Bob is not an easy person. You see, he's very diplomatic too. You know, especially he has a very good respect and a great respect rather for me. You know, anything that is not right, he would not do in front of me. Whatever. Yes.
I see.
He has a great respect, as I had come from Ethiopia.
Yes.
And he was really a very respectful person.
Yes.
And we had no much discuss. But one thing I remember about him, about dreadlock, is that I asked him, Bob, why do other children, Rasta children, they grow their hair from, because I see little ones also grow their dread.
Yes, yes.
It become dread. I told him, his children, all of them had nothing. So why then? I said to him, Abba, I would never persecute my children. I would never force them to do. When they grow, if they like it, they will make decision for themselves.
Yes.
That's what he told me.
But he didn't force them.
It was really great, you know.